I'm Jeff Bradshaw of Redneck Restorations. This old truck brought to you by ElderlyIron.com, the internet's only auction site dedicated to old cars, trucks, tractors, and related parts. Old Blue here took a dump on me. Well, sometime last fall, I bought this 87 Chevy Sprint. It wasn't much of a car, but it didn't cost much money either. Got it running when gas prices went up, skyrocketing on us. And then while I was driving it, I noticed the charging light was coming on and found out it was overcharging the system. And that had its tendency to burn out ignition modules. So that's exactly what it did. Well, I hooked the trailer up to Old Blue here, went down to go get it, realized I didn't have the keys. So I got to turn around when I get to the end of the road. There goes that tool down in the ground. See if the goats pick it up, carry it off somewhere. Anyway, I realized I didn't have the keys, had to turn around when I hit the shoulder of the road coming back up. Made a great big bang, and about 10 feet later, the truck died. And I have fuel to the carburetor, but it's still running out of gas, so I probably jostled a bunch of dirt around there and plugged up the jets. And I've had problems with this carburetor already. Accelerator pump's gone in it, so might as well just get it off of here. So that's what we're gonna do. Now this engine is a 1977 Chevy truck 350 in a 1969 GMC, and whoever built it had the presence of mind to stick an Edelbrock torquer manifold on it. Well, an Edelbrock torquer manifold is just looks like a spider sitting on here, and they're great for the 3500 RPM range and above. So if you got a circle track racer, or quarter miler, great manifold. But if you got a 3/4 ton truck with 456 gears, not the manifold of choice. So, while doing some scrapping a while back, I came across an engine somebody was gonna scrap, 350 Chevy. Had an Edelbrock Performer manifold on it, which is an aluminum intake manifold, pretty much like the stock manifold. It also takes a spread bore or quadrajet. So I've got that manifold sitting over on a shelf, and I've got a quadrajet sitting on the shelf. And someday I'll get to putting that on here. But for right now, I just need this truck to run. Because I got to get my trailer over to somewhere that's got a whole bunch of these pallets that are 8.5 foot by 5 foot. Stacks of them. They make great fence. And since I had to walk up and down the mountain twice last night looking for my cows that got out again, I gotta go get some of those panels. First, I'm getting awful tired chasing cows till dark. So after I got done running up and down the mountain, I come pulling back in the house. My wife's out there, said something big is in the backyard looking at her. Sure enough, there stood both of the cows standing in the orchard behind the barn. Already made their way through the garden. Again. In the camera where everybody can see you. Knock the tools all off the front of the truck. Good goat, good goat. And you thinking a goat wouldn't come and take off with the tools? Think again. Come on, throttle spring. There we go. One Carter AVS. Well, now when you clean your carburetor and all you got's cans, just kind of wet the outside. Don't just sit there and continually spray and use your carburetor cleaner to spray the stuff off, or you go through a lot of carburetor cleaner. Give yourself a little brush. Now, if you're lazy and you don't feel like brushing it, and you got a lot of money for carburetor cleaner, spray away. Or if you've got a nice 5-gallon bucket of chem dip, like I used to have, you just drop it in there and soak it. Once you've used your brush, break up all the nasty stuff, then come back and rinse it. Again, get it all wet first. Then once you got it all clean, then you can take it apart, which is actually the opposite of how you would normally rebuild a carburetor. But this is Redneck Restorations. Just what are you thinking? All clean and ready for disassembly. Priceless tool for anybody that does carb work. Well, even though I've rolled this around a few times, still a bunch of stuff laying in the bowls. There's some crappy crud. That didn't sound good, and it wasn't. Got me a big fat-bladed screwdriver, so that wouldn't happen. Broke the brass right off the top of the jet. Well, it looks like that one's not coming out. Well, I'm not going to worry about it. Got this can of carb cleaner at an auction. It's part of a whole pallet of stuff. Didn't have a button on it. I can't find a button that fits it either. But it works good for what we're doing here. Just fill up the fuel well. Slosh it around. Well, got a carburetor kit and our cans of carburetor cleaner. So now we want to do our passages. Make sure you get into all of them. Secondary fuel passages. These are the air bleeds. Those are your fuel passages, your main wells. You can see the brown crud coming up out of the jet. Woo! Almost got the camera. Better point this one away. What do you know? More gelatinous goo. This is not the way you really rebuild a carburetor, but this is the way you do it when you don't have all the other stuff. Always want to blow backwards whenever you can. Opposite direction of the fuel travel. Final rinse down, that's going to have to do. Clean! Time for the kit! It used to be they only sent you the leather cup. Now they're sending you the whole plunger again. Accelerator pump. Now my important instructions say that my float level is to be number 2. IDC. Well, we can go anywhere from 7/32 to 5/16. I prefer the higher number. 5/16 is 10/32, which lowers the float level, lowers my fuel level, and I just assume run it a little bit lean. If it doesn't work out, I'll pull it apart and change it. So somewhere in here they provide you a gauge. Oh, and they put it in decimal equivalents. Here's the 7/32. Way low. Here's 3/12. When you're adjusting floats, you don't take and push that thing down against the needle valve.
And a lot of times, if you don't have a float gauge and you're looking for a way to set your float, generally if you just make the float parallel with the top of your air horn, you make this parallel right here, bottom of this float, or the top of the float as it were, parallel with that gasket, you'll generally get by. That's only if you don't have the tools and the specifications. Otherwise, put it where it belongs. I generally don't pay too much attention to float drop, but in this particular case, one of them is way off. So, I will go back to my specification chart. Float drop, 23/32. That ought to be easy enough to measure, huh? Well now, my accelerator pump does not want to return. No, there was no spring underneath that when I took it apart, was there? Well, I've never had this carburetor apart, so I would imagine that's why my old accelerator never worked. Because there was no spring under there to push it back to the top. I do, however, have another basket case carburetor upstairs. Now, because of the way this thing was set up, choke didn't work, not much anyway, and the accelerator pump didn't work. So if it was ever cold and you wanted to start it, go get your can of starting fluid. That's the only way it's ever going to happen. One accelerator pump spring, that'll do just dandy. One accelerator pump. There we go. All of our linkages hooked up. Our idle mixture screws are in lightly all the way. We're going to back that out. Two turns. It's a good start. One half, one, one and a half, two. That'll get you running. Okay, time to put it on the truck. I have to see if I can get it on here before the goats come and take the tools away. Again, when you're tightening your bolts down, do it incrementally. Go to your farthest bolt next. See me use some starting fluid. And that's because I don't have much battery. That ought to do. That ought to fall out of there in no time. Now, some of you are probably saying, well, if you had so much crud in your carburetor, why aren't you changing the fuel filter? Well, you're right. Why aren't I?
Probably. Because I didn't think about it. I call that ready. Now, one of the things I get a chuckle out of on some of these YouTube things is guys get up here and you just pump that thing for everything it's worth. Well, when you got an empty fuel bowl, you ain't doing nothing. Ah, not another tool. Rusty clamp just don't want to yard down hard enough. Let's see what that does. Half. What we're doing is called the lean drop method. Keep backing it out so it doesn't make any difference at all. You run it back in until it just drops. Just back it out slightly. That's a two turn right there. Now we're going to go by quarter turn. Even better. Here, smooth out some more. We're 2.5. It didn't make any difference. Another quarter turn. Didn't make any difference. We'll go back in 1/2. Didn't make any difference. Back in another quarter. We hear it start to drop down a little bit, so I'm going to back it out that quarter, and that's where we're going to leave it. We're at 2.25 on the left side. The right side doesn't seem to be making much of a difference, which tells me that somebody's probably run these metering kits in and smashed the seats open where you can't get a fine adjustment on it anymore.
Stabilization check. Wonder how it'll do in the third gear wrong. Smells more like clutch than anything.
Yep.
Smelled like clutch. I'll bet it wasn't spinning the tire.
Pallets. some more pellets. Keep the cows in. Redneck Restoration's this old truck. I'm Jeff Bradshaw.
I wonder what that was. I bet there's a cat involved.
Wait on.